really an on-time message. And I want to kind of piggyback. Then Danielle took it. Minister Danielle took it Wednesday night, expounded even more upon it. If you're, how many are here Wednesday night? You're in service. It was really good and powerful. I really wanted you to get this today. I figured something out. I was studying this out. I spent about 3 hours last night putting this together. And I really figured out something. I was like, man, how do people sit around in church, see miracles take place, travel all over the earth, see miracles take place, see, know the Word of God, but have no expectation, or they really kind of fall in their heart? And I was like, how does this really happen? So I began to really pray and ask God's revelation in my life so I could share it with you, because I think a lot of people, how many of you have got on fire, and all of a sudden, you can feel it this morning, you get your heart a little hardened, and you really just don't feel like worshiping or feel like getting out of bed, and whatever it is, you know, it's cold today, it's the first cold day Sunday we've had in forever, you know, you don't want to get out of bed, and I figured it out. What's happened is, you know, something's happened to your heart. Remember I talked about everything comes from your heart. We look with our eyes, and we sense with our ears and our eyes, but we really should be sensing with our heart. But when our heart becomes cold, and when our heart becomes numb to the Word of God, that's where we get in trouble. So I want to elaborate on that today, and I think you're going to see this. Let's look at 2 Timothy 1 and 7. How many of you are ready for the Word today? I promise you, if you'll listen to this, Wally said it the other day, I've been in a teaching mode lately. If you want to hear preaching, you come on Wednesday night. I've been in a teaching mode because I think somebody said something the other week. They said, I come to church now, I take notes. I've really never been interested. I come for the power, but now I'm listening to the Word. And I'm telling you, that's a great compliment, because if you're learning something and you're getting an understanding of God's Word, then we're doing something in the kingdom of God. You should leave here with more than you came in with, right? Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. 2 Timothy 1 and 7 said, for God has not given us a spirit of what? But of what? Power. And of love and of a sound mind. All right? Everybody say power, love, and a sound mind. I believe that the reason, have you ever seen believers fall in traps? Yes? You fell in traps. We all been in traps. I believe the reason so many believers fall in traps of fear and anxiety, and you know, do you know when you fall in those traps of fear and anxiety? When you're in, everybody say, life crisis. Any of y'all ever had one of those? Okay. When you have a life crisis is when fear and anxiety comes this way. I think everybody's freezing now, so I don't know. We've turned the air on. We've turned it off. This is the time of season, but just hallelujah, we'll turn the heat on, whatever. I don't care. But anyway, no, somebody said no. But it's when you're in a life crisis, and what happens is during that fear and anxiety in that life crisis, you allow the enemy to completely distract you, and I think that's what happens. This morning, we all had football. We all had something else on our mind. We all had whatever it was. But we came here today, and we were a little distracted, right? Some people were like, I don't know if we're having church this morning. We always have church on Sunday morning. We may not have it on Sunday nights, but you know we're going to be here on Sunday mornings, right? But there's always something. The enemy's always trying to distract you, right? And what happens is, I really believe that a lot of us forget that God's already equipped us to handle everything that comes our way. Remember we talked about last week, you go through the wilderness, Jesus went in, David went in, Paul went in, so we are going to go in, right? And count it a privilege that God is leading you into a wilderness place in your life. If you're not going into a wilderness stage, then you're not being prepared for the promised land. Does that make sense? Okay. So, how many of you ever felt blindsided? And I know when you feel blind about something you didn't see coming, how many of you want to question God? Why did this happen? Why am I going through this situation? Why have I ever been through this? I want to answer some of those questions today. And I want you to know this, that no matter what you're going through in your life right now, what kind of life crisis, what kind of situation, it may be joyful, it may be painful, whatever it is, that nothing surprises God. Say that. He already knows what you're going through, and he knows how you're going to come out of it, right? So he's seen ahead, and here's the great news. He's prepared a way of escape. I don't usually have dreams, but I had a dream one night, and it was kind of like this place where Paul and Silas was. I went on a mission trip or something. I can't remember exactly where I was, but I was in this brick encased thing, and there was no way of escape, right? And I was trying to figure out how I could slither out of it or whatever. And it just didn't seem like there was no way of escape. I woke up, praise God, and I got out of it. I don't know about y'all. I don't like being in no closed situation, right? But how many of y'all know that God's already prepared us a way of escape? My way of escape was I woke up. Said, praise the Lord, I ain't in that hole I was in. Amen? And here's the thing. I think a lot of people get around, they start doubting God's word. How many of y'all know God's word is always true? It is always powerful. It always works. I don't care what people say, what people do. God's word always works. Amen? And when you worship and you praise him and you sacrifice for him, fire will fall in your life every time. You know, so, you know, sometimes people leave church and they go, well, Bishop didn't bring it today. Minister Sabrina didn't bring it today. No, you didn't bring it today. And I'm going to explain why you did. What happens is, how many of y'all see miracles? Raise your hand. Power. How many of y'all seen the power of God work in your life? Raise your hand. Okay? Then how come y'all don't stay on fire all the time? I'm going to tell you why. Amen? And I just don't want to get ahead of myself, so I'll tell you in a minute. But the question is, how are you going to respond to that difficulty, right? You can sit around doubting God's word. You can make up excuses. Here's what most people do. When things don't work in their life, according to the word of God, they start making up excuses, right? Say amen. And you know what? What do they make up excuses for, Gwen? They make up excuses for things they don't understand. Like, oh, Bishop's teaching this, and I don't believe that way. Well, you know what? You don't believe that way because it ain't working for you, silly, because you ain't trying it. Amen? You know, and I'm going to tell you this. I try it again, and I'll tell God. I'll say, hey, God, I'm going to worship you till you fall. Amen? Fire's got to fall, just sacrifice. I'm going to sacrifice what I'm doing and believe in you, God, that you're going to move in my life no matter what. But when you start making excuses that God's word don't work, that's where the source of bad theology comes into your life. You start saying, well, maybe I'll believe the way the Baptists, the Methodists, the Presbyterian, I'll start believing this, I'll believe that. And then you get all confused. You say, I don't believe that. But, you know, it don't matter what you believe. It's your personal relationship between you and Jesus Christ. And I will tell you this, whatever your heart is sensing and whatever your faith is telling you to do, you better do it for the kingdom of God, I'm telling you right now. And know that God's word works every single time. Amen? But the problem is, and sometimes when you make excuses for things you don't understand, you'll fall into those fear and disappointments, right? Because you don't understand, how could God love me so much that he forgave every sin that I would ever commit on the cross, that all I got to do is believe in him and I should not perish but have everlasting life? People don't understand that. But so what happens is the devil talks you out of your destiny and pulls you into a place of fear and disappointments, right? You figure out your life. And here's the things. Everybody say, this cannot be my option as a believer. You can't be talked out of what you believe. You can't be talked out of what the Word of God says, right? Amen. Because what happened, and I'm going to show you this today. If you say, I, the believer, if you're the believer not sensitive to what your heart is teaching you, then you won't know how to use the tools that God has given you to get out of where you're at. Does that make sense? All right? So what happens? You start complaining, you start moaning and groaning. The disciples, hey, you ain't got nothing on the disciples. They did the same thing. I'm about to teach you about it right now. But what happens is he gives you those tools to prepare. It helps you get out of the situation or helps you prepare before an encounter becomes a challenge. Does that make sense? Do you understand what I'm saying? So look at the disciples. Do you remember when they remember the miracle of the fishes and the bread? Y'all remember that? What happened? Anybody know? They had all these people, right? And they didn't have enough bread. So who was there? The disciples were there, right? Jesus was about to teach him about the miracle that whatever you have is enough whenever Christ is involved. So if I make $8 or I make $8 million, but I'm a believer, I still have as much as the man that has $8 million. Amen. Amen. And I'm just going to strive to get where he is, right? You believe that? But they witnessed the miracles of the fishes and the bread. But and remember, right after that, what happened? They got on a boat, didn't they, Wally? They got on a boat, and what happened on the boat? A storm came up, right? So they got on the boat, and what happened? Jesus walked on the water. Remember that? But the disciples, what happened? Let me ask you. I bet you I don't even know this. There's a verse, I guarantee you, that you've been preached. You've heard this. How many of y'all have heard this story I'm about to tell about Jesus walking on water? There is a verse that nobody's ever taught y'all. Amen? Are you excited? Because I'm going to teach you something you ain't never. I bet you ain't never heard this because nobody's ever taught you. You know how I know? I've been doing this 20 years, and I've been 49 years, almost 50 this year. Amen? And nobody's ever taught me this. I never knew this. I'm excited, right? I'm excited to share this with you. So were the disciples there during the miracle? So they should be prepared, right? How many of y'all see miracles take place right here? How many see miracles take place in your life? then why do people fall out of church and say, well, that church ain't for me? I'm going to show you. Watch what happens. So Jesus goes out of the boat. He walks in the middle of the water, right? What did he do? The storm just kept raging, didn't it? No, it didn't. He walked on the water and he calmed the storm. Now, they just had came out of this miracle power. We came out of last Sunday morning, power, miracle, Wednesday night, power, miracle. We come here today, we're all passive. Why is that? You guys fell right into my message. Why is that? What was different last Sunday than this Sunday morning? Ah, say me. I'm going to show you why. Watch what happened. The disciples were troubled by what they seen, the demonstration of power. They were troubled because of their own unbelief. And they never seen, have you? I ain't never seen a man walk on water. I'd be troubled too. But also have never seen three fishes and four loaves of bread, whatever it was, feed 5,000 people either. Have you? So what he was trying, let me stay right here. The disciples, so they were, their own unbelief and their lack of ability were their own authority. So let's look at Mark. Mark 6 and 50. And when we get to 52, you've never been taught this. I know, I figured out what was wrong with the disciples. All right, so here we go. For they all saw him, but immediately he taught with them and said to them what? It is I, be not afraid. 51. For they had not, then he went up in the boat to them, and the wind what? And they were what? In themselves, beyond measure, and they, stay right here. So he went in the boat. Why were they amazed? But they just had seen the miracle, right? They just had seen the miracle of the bread and the fishes, right? They were amazed, and the Bible says, beyond measure. And they marveled. Now, I'm about to show you something. I'm going to show you. Everybody say, why were they that way? Why were you this way this morning? I'm about to tell you. Go ahead, next verse. 52. You've never been taught this. For they had not understood about the loaves, because their heart was. Let me read it again. Nobody, have you ever heard of this? No, you have not. For they had not understood about the loaves. So they weren't prepared for the walking on the water. They didn't understand that they just had seen a mirror. See, y'all are in a place that's going to change the earth. You don't understand. You ain't perceived it yet. Y'all don't even realize that you remnant of people have been chosen by God to change the earth. Y'all don't understand it. Because if you did, I would have to pull y'all off the roof here every Sunday morning. For they didn't understand about the loaves. Why? Because you have become numb to what God is doing here. You become numb. We go to Africa, the plate, man, they bust it. They tear this roof. If I brought the congregation from Kowal West to here, they would rip this roof apart. Amen. And they ain't got no cars to get to church or anything. They walk. But what I'm telling you is right now, they did not understand about the loaves because their heart was. What you do, God softens it up. We break out and shout, hey, top of my head to the soles of my feet. During the week, your heart gets cold again. Amen? Have you ever put meat in a fridge? Have you ever went to the grocery store and you bought 5 pounds or a pound and a half of ground chuck? It's squishy, right? Soft, right? You throw in the frying pan and cook it in no time, right? You go put it in the freezer for a week, what happens? Can you throw it in the freezer? It's a brick. That's where y'all were this morning. I threw y'all in the frying pan, and the heat, what, did the heat change? But it's going to take a whole lot longer to cook the meat, isn't it? Same situation. How long is it going to take to de-thaw you? Hey, I done went home, took me a nap by the time most of y'all done got thawed out. Same way with the apostles, amen? They seen the miracle, amen? They didn't understand the lows. If you understood who you were and who God called you to be, you'd be on fire today. See? Nothing was surprising. But God cannot take us past the lows to the walking on the water till you people are prepared for the lows. Crippled girl never walked, gets healed. They've already been to the loaves and the bread. They've already seen the water walking. Now they're ready to see the supernatural miracles. Can't see it because you're hard. There's no... I don't say everybody. There was probably zero expectation of a miracle taking place this morning. How many of you woke up this morning saying, God, there's going to be a great miracle in the house today? God, something miraculous is taking place in my life today. How many of you said that? And what Jesus was doing was training them to do what he did, right? Every miracle he did in their presence was teaching them to live in that revelation. When you see the power of God fall in the house, and you see the power of God fall in your life, it is a teaching experience not to stay in that place, but to graduate to another place. Right? Are y'all getting this? I hope you are. Listen. All right. Basic, you got born again. That's primary. What do you call before primary school? Kindergarten, right? Okay. Most believers today are still in kindergarten. Okay, they've never graduated from the day that... if you ask most believers what's the greatest day of their life, it's the day they got born again. How could that be the greatest day? Today is the greatest day of my life. Amen? That was the beginning of the greatest day of my life, right? So every miracle he did was teaching them to live in that revelation. He was teaching them how to calm a storm in the midst of chaos, right? He had done that with the bread and the fishes. He was teaching them... All right, so there's chaos in my life. There's a storm in my life. He was teaching them how to calm the storm. He had already taught them how to feed people, amen, when there was a need. If they hungered, hey, I have enough to feed them. So he was gradually taking them. That was a, let's say it was the elementary miracle. But God was trying to take them to a new place, right? To a new position, a new place, a new miracle, a new strength of miracles. He was trying to teach them, amen? But they weren't prepared for it. Why? Because their heart was hardened, right? So he was methodically teaching them. That's what we try to do. But here's the problem. If every year we have to constantly back up and reteach all you people, and every year then we're going to see the same, we're going to see a few miracles. Remember what Jesus said? In Nazareth, how many miracles did he do? Very few. Amen? But wherever he went, there were supernatural miracles taking place everywhere. Why? Because they believed and because their heart wasn't hardened. What happens is our heart becomes hardened because our expectation is we're going to have this every single time. But God is not satisfied where we are. He's not, I'll tell Sabrina that, he's not satisfied with a praise team. He's not satisfied with a bishop. He's not satisfied with a congregation. He don't want us at the level we were in 2015. Amen. He said, you better loosen up your heart. He said, you better not put it in the freezer. You better keep it thawed out and ready whenever it's time to eat. Right? So, it's kind of like, how many of y'all have basic math? Remember that? That's really all I know how to do. If y'all want, really. Math 101, 3 plus 2. You give me a budget, I can figure it out. You give me 7A plus 3B equals 14A. That's way over my head. Right? But what he was trying to do, he taught them basic, like basic math, but he was ready to teach them algebra, right? But here's the problem is, they couldn't move on because they didn't understand the first lesson. Are you with me? Some of you are in a place where you can't move on. You've hardened your heart. You said, this is as far as I'm going to go. I see it. God bless all y'all. I know some of y'all watched the movie War Room. I haven't seen it. Y'all got your war closets and all that kind of stuff. Man, won't you bring that stuff here with you, amen? Won't you bring the power? Hey, I'm going to tell you, if you pray at home, you sure should pray here. If you worship and trot around your house like this, some of y'all say y'all trot around your house praying. I ain't never seen y'all pray here. I got me a prayer closet. Yes, I do. I got a prayer. How about you? It's wherever I go is my closet. Right. I lift up the name of Jesus. Amen. Hey, it's nothing wrong with it. If you got to go to a place and get with you and God, that's good with you. Amen. But I'm telling you right now, it's time we gravitate. It's time we elevate. It's time we go to places we ain't never been. Amen. It's time that we loosen up our heart and we pray in the Holy Ghost that we see the manifestation of God in our life. That prayer clause ain't going to do a bit of good if you don't know how to pray. enemy has got people believing. Most people pray for what they've already got. They're asking God to do something he's already done. God will not hear that prayer. You will pray in that closet till you rip the sheetrock off of it. And he will not hear you. But when you begin to thank God for the manifestation of the Holy Ghost, thank God for the understanding, the learning of his word, and for you gravitating to a new level every day, then you'll start seeing the manifestation of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. You see what I'm talking about? Most of a believer's prayer life today is thanking God for what he's already done in your life. Thank you, God. You say, well, Bishop, I need some money to pay my bills. Thank God that he's gave you the money to pay the bills. If you ask God to give you the money to pay the bills, he will not hear that prayer. Amen. If you ask God to heal your body, by didn't he do away with it? I'll ask you this. Jesus conquered death, hell, and the grave. Right? Do you believe that? All right, I could go into that for an hour, but I'll stay on this. So let me go slow. Why didn't they get the lesson of the loaves? Because their hearts were hard. Why do you come in here and see the manifestation of God? Why do you go on mission trips to the manifestation of God? Why do you go out? You know, people say, oh, I got to go here, go there. I got to go do it. No, you can get everything you need right here. If you, with a hard heart, you can go see, you can go raise T.L. Osborne from the dead and let him preach to you, and you'll be the same way you were when he left, right? Are you with me? You can go get Jesus, and you can go try to go get somebody out of the grave. You can do whatever. You say, hey, you go do something, go get Paul, wherever he is, and try to get him to preach to you. And if your heart is hardened, it don't matter. Does that make sense? I don't care who you hear. You can go hear Hillsong. You can go hear whoever. But if your heart is hardened, you're not going to do anything. So what does that mean? What happens, if you lack basic faith, I don't care who lays hands on you. I don't care who tells you you're going to your next destination. You will miss your destiny, because if you lack basic faith and you're always making an excuse for why things don't work, oh, my husband's jacked up, oh, my wife's messed up, oh, I just didn't feel it today, oh, y'all are too crazy for me, you will never get to where you need to be in the kingdom of God. If you lack basic faith and understanding of how he works to teach us, right? He was teaching them, and he's teaching you, and he's teaching us, to get ready for the next level of our life. He was teaching us in 2015 that 2015 was just the beginning of the new day that he had for us. 2015 was just a preparation of the go ye. 2015 was a preparation to build a new building. Yeah, but we can't stay in the basic understanding, just sit around. You know what the problem with most people is? They sit around and wait on God to do something he's already done. I'm waiting on God to send me. Where does it say? He's already sent you. He said, go ye. Did he not? God's already prepared you for the miracles. He told the 70 to go out. He said even the devils would be subject unto them. They came back and said, hey, Jesus, you ain't going to believe this, but even the devils. He'd already told them, and they had to see it, right? And you've seen that. That's why you got to pray and thank God. Prayer is good. Thanking God in prayer is good. And that's what we're doing. We're praying and fasting. But I want you to pray and worship. I'd rather you worship and pray and thank God, run around your house, man, praying and worshiping and going buck wild, amen, and letting your heart stay soft and not get hardened during this time. Because what's going to happen is the things you're giving up during this fast are going to challenge your heart. Because some of you are going to try to quit smoking. Some of you are going to try to quit your drug problem. Some of you are going to try to quit your eating problem. Some of you are going to try to get healthier. Some of you are going to try to, you know, whatever it is, right? But what the devil's going to do is he's going to challenge you right in that area of your heart, amen? And when it gets to the most challenging, you got to gravitate to that next level, right? But if you let your heart get hard and you start grinding this thing out, this fast out, just to get to the end of it, you won't learn a thing. You'll come out of the fast the same way you got in it, right? He was teaching them about facing another storm. Think about this. How many of you have been participants in a miracle before? Right? They were participants in the miracle. They seen it. They seen it manifested. They were part of bringing it. Were they a part of bringing forth the miracle? They passed out the loaves of bread, didn't they? And never ran out. So they were even a participant, right? You all, if you've been here very long, have been a participant, right? So, but they still And here's where I think a lot of you lack, and a lot of times we do, I do too. You still don't comprehend the tools that God has made available, because when we get passive about it with a hard heart, we don't recognize that there's a way of escape, okay? Some of you may be that way today. You've seen the miracles because you just want to. You developed a hard heart. You've seen the miracles take place. You've seen how God blessed others. But because you want to, you developed a hard heart, right? How many of you know God's going to heal your children? Okay, well, don't get dismayed when it seems like they're not being healed. How many of you know that your body's got to come in line with the Word of God? Amen? Well, don't be dismayed when it don't come to place right away. You know what happens is we lose our focus and we get a hard heart because things ain't going our way. But if we truly believe, amen, and we truly sense with our heart, then we'll see the manifestation of God, right? So if some of you developed a hard heart, I rebuke that right now. I rebuke every hard heart in the name of Jesus. You know why I did that? Because Jesus rebuked the disciples to give them a chance to repent and recover what they had missed in the first miracle. So what today is, you got to start thanking God for softening your heart. You got to start thanking God for loosening that bond and that band. We sing it all the time, you know, the chains or the shackles. You got a shackle in your heart. It's a hard heart. You said, you know what, this is my way. I'm going to go this way, and it's the only way. And you wonder why things are not working. It's because that heart of yours is not repenting. You haven't repented. But here's the thing. When you do that and you recover what you missed during that miracle, what's going to happen is you're going to be able to reconnect. Everybody say reconnect. And how many of you have done this? Felt like God was far away, but all of a sudden you felt like there was a reconnection. You ever mess with that? I don't understand remotes. And when Tyler, my son's home, Tyler, he comes home, he messes with the TV, and none of the remotes work, right? Okay? And I don't understand them things. And, you know, you start hitting every button on there, and when it comes on, you're like, praise the Lord, man, I got reconnected. You're excited. You're like, I ain't touching nothing else. Bro, I'm going to leave that thing right there. That's the way we got to be with the kingdom of God. You know, sometimes you just got to keep hitting buttons. You don't know where it's going to work, but all of a sudden it comes on you. Whoa, praise. Don't try to figure out where it came from. Don't try to reanalyze it. Just receive it and sit down and relax and let God do what he's going to do. Amen. I don't care how you get reconnected today, just get reconnected. Amen. Maybe it pushes a button. Maybe we hit a button today, whatever it is. But you got to get rid of that hard heart. Amen. That's why the disciples didn't receive the miracle. That's why you don't see the miracles. That's why you don't see the power of God, because you've got a hard heart, right? And you let the things of the world come in place, right? So if you look back and think about it, God has given us all a tool, a word. How many of you had a tough life or a tough week and somebody gave you a word and changed your life? Amen. Miss Donna Hayes gave me a couple of them. Amen. She could read your book, couldn't she? Amen. So what happens is, I guarantee there's some of you facing a situation that seems really beyond your control. But if you'll look back and think about it, God has given you every single tool. A word of scripture, a verse that jumps out and ministered to you. The word Wednesday night ministered to me. Amen. It jumped back out. It jumped back out and grabbed me. Brought me. I was like, oh, praise the Lord. I see that. I see it. It gave me the premise for this message today. You know, you listen, and when you come to the house of God, there may be that one button, that one word, that one part of the message, that one song they sing. There may be the button that reconnects you with the kingdom of God. I don't care about your, let me say this right. I don't care about your relationships on earth. I care about your relationship with Jesus first. I don't care how great your relationships are with your pastor, how great your relationships are with your friends. If you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you don't have a relationship. All right? So here's what you got to do. How do I do it? Repent. What does repent mean? Turn around. Get rid of it and use what God has shown you to be set free. You know, I'm trying to do this. I'm trying to convince you all that, and I said it earlier, you people are great people of identity and purpose, right? You know why I say that? Because you're identified with Christ. And I know that he has a purpose for all of us. That all of you are prepared for the moment you're standing in, right? Are you prepared? I want you to be prepared. That all of heaven is waiting to back you and me up as we choose to be faithful, okay? This is that our life, everybody say my life, is about to shift. How many of you want your life to shift? That you should open up to the life lessons learned and the reality all around us. You may be in a predicament. And see, a lot of times we think, how many of you know that what the enemy tries to make bad for us, that God has already prepared tools for us to come out of it better than we went in. And sometimes, have you ever had family members turn on you? Nobody, right? You ever had your work turn on you? I'm going to read something. I want you to see this. How many of y'all remember Joseph? Joseph. Remember Joseph? He was cast away by his brothers, right? Did he come into his destiny? Say, yeah. He saw God's plans. He saw what God's plans were that had momentum and power that blew the devil's, his own brother's plan, right, blew it away. Let's look at Genesis 50 and 20. So you remember the story of Joseph. He got sold into slavery by his brothers. He got put in a pit. So they thought he was going to be cast away, done away as a slave. They'd never hear from him again, right? So the enemy and his own family had plans for his demise. The enemy has plans for all of you, all your demise. But how you come out of it, in the situation, no matter how bad it is right now, you got to know that God's power and momentum is going to catapult you out of it. Watch this. But as for you, you meant evil against me. But everybody say, but God meant it for good. So you mean, Bishop, what I'm going through right now, my present situation, my tough situation, my hard life that I'm going through now, God don't put evil on nobody. I'm telling you that. But when you led into that situation like Job was, even like Paul or Saul was when he was converting, that God meant it for good in order, watch this, ready? In order to bring it about as it this day to save many people lives. So let's go slow. So you mean I'm going through what I'm going through now, this trial in my life, this rough time in my life, so that I may save more people down the road than I ever have? Because watch this. Joseph could not have reached his destiny had he not been sold into slavery. I dare to say, Linda, you wouldn't reach your potential had you not went through the storm that you went through, that God didn't send the cancer, God didn't send the pain, but what the devil meant for bad, God meant for good, and you've changed the lives of many people. It happened. Stuff's happened in your life, hasn't it? Huh? Say it's happened. So now, how many of you know that you're going to come out and that God can use what the situation, the badness, the ugliness, to come out smelling like a rose to help other people? He said, to bring it about as it this day to save many people what? Alive. Joseph, listen to this. He doesn't deny. Now, I know that people's decisions and the situations you've been through in your life have affected you. Joseph doesn't deny that he went through many lonely days, right? He was a prisoner. He was in slavery. But he didn't deny that at all. But, everybody say but. He chooses to focus on the reality that their plans, the devil's plans, could not cancel out God's destiny for him in his life. Remember David the same way? His brothers were jealous of him, but their plans did not cancel out his destiny. Saul hated David, amen? He was jealous of David, amen? But it didn't matter what Saul did, David took the tools that God gave him, amen, to reach the kingship and help many people, right? So what the enemy meant for bad, God will take around and spin for good for you, right? In fact, the wicked actions, those wicked actions became the same tools God used to bring Joseph to his promotion. The same tools. The enemy will give you, he'll bring you into the valley of the shadow of death, but God will give you the tool. Those same tools that he led you into the shadow of death, God will use those same tools to bring you out of the shadow of death. Well, I'm depressed. I can't make decisions. Well, if you were in tune with the Holy Spirit of God, you'd gravitate, and amen, you'd get to college. You know, I'm telling you right now, we need to be gravitating. This year ought to be a year of growth and a year of understanding. Maybe you don't believe every, Pastor Chris may teach something I don't agree. Sometimes I may say something he don't agree. But we're all in this together, right? Amen. And we're all pushing to the same goal. We're all pushing for the same word and the same destiny, amen, that God has called us. If y'all don't believe that the United States of America is in a pickle or in a mess, then you better open your eyes. Why not us? Why not the same tools that the enemy meant for destruction for America? We can pick up those same tools and whoop the devil in his own game and take back the United States of America. Amen. So we know God doesn't bring on evil. Evil cannot, but here's the thing. And evil cannot limit his desire to set us in heavenly places. Amen? So he can't. It can't limit, and it can't do anything that God has stopped. Anything to stop what God has already purposed in our life. So you went through it. I know somebody that I told you last week. Somebody's car motor blew up. Amen. In the midst of the car blowing up, they decided to take on a new challenge and just believe God and just say, I'm going on a mission trip. Praise God. Can I dare to say, had the motor not blew up, they wouldn't have made the decision to even go. I ain't putting words in their mouth, but I believe that I got in the Holy Ghost. But when you find your place in a place of despair, in a place where you don't know how to get out of, pick the tools up that the devil meant for bad and start whooping at them in his own game. You ever seen a bully maybe come at you with a stick, you take it away from him and you beat him half the... I remember one time, I'll just say this. One time my dad was coming at me and I kind of picked up a stick. He took that stick, beat me from the house to the barn with that stick. Amen. And that's what we got to do with the devil. What he intended, man, take it back and beat him with it and come out of it. Amen. And that's what you do. You feel like, man, there ain't no hope. There's no situation. Well, you know what? I got the tools God has gave me, you know, and I'm going to pick these up and I'm going to go forward and do what God has called me to do. Even though it don't make no sense. I'm going to go, you know what? Jesus is walking on that water. He's trying to teach me something. I think I can walk on that water. He was teaching them how to calm the storm. When there was a midst of chaos. Y'all got chaos in your families. You know you can speak, peace be still, and cast your cares upon God and watch the waters calm. And when they know you don't care no more, they start leaving you alone. Bishop, you don't care about nothing. Cast all your cares. But the Bible says, care is a word the enemy's hijacked and made it sound good when it really is, the root of care is anxiety and stress. Where does that come from? That's fear-based. Comes from the pits of hell. Well, Bishop, you should care. I don't care. I love, hey, you don't care about the orphanage? No, I love the orphanage in Africa. And I'm going to sow into it. I've already cast my cares. I'm not worried about it. I believe that woman will feed them. I believe God will provide food every single day if she has 160 kids. You see what I'm talking about? Well, Bishop, you know your checkbook looks a little... No, I don't believe what my checkbook says. I believe what God says. Oh, the doctor said... I don't care what the doctor said. Oh, let me go further. My body said this morning it's cold and I want to stay in the bed. I told my body, no, I'm getting up and I'm going to church and worship today. Amen? One seeking signs, wonders, and miracles. My heart ain't going to be hardened. You know, if I stayed in bed and I slept and rolled over, my heart would be cold right now. Amen. Miss one service, you'll miss two. You miss two, you miss four. You miss four, you're done. You are. If you miss four powerful worship services, you got to start over. Oh, you're lying. I've seen it right here for 20 years. People, they lay out, and when they come back, it don't feel the same. They're like, you'll see them. They'll come back in, they're like, we'll be bouncing around all, and they're like, it don't feel the same. You know why? Because they went back to the basic algebra, basic math. They went all the way back. And you know what you got to do? You can come out of it, but you got to pick up the tools and start beating the devil with it again. You can come out of it, and there's hope. But why even get in that place? Why even get in that? I don't want to start over. I've been there. You say, well, Bishop, you ain't there. I've been there. I picked up the tools the enemy meant for destruction. I beat him in his own game, and I'm helping people in their life right now. Amen? So why not us? See, we hear the story about walking on water. Nobody ever told us the disciples were afraid because their hearts were hardened. The reason you're not feeling anything today is because your heart is not sensing anymore. Amen? And how do you do that? I just told you, repent. Not for God, but for you. You turn around and you get in that prayer closet, you start thanking God for your blessings. We used to do a song, you know, thank you, Lord, for your blessings. Remember that? We don't do that anymore. Why don't we thank God for the miracles? Thank God that he's given us an opportunity to step in. I don't even know where Juan Cayo, Peru is. But I'm going. I don't know how I'm going to get there. Some of y'all was like, how long is the bus ride? Do we go up mountains? I don't care. I know God said go. I'm going to go and do what I just did right here. She gonna go sing and worship like she does here. Amen. Don't care where it is, that's in the go ye. And God says, go, you go. Well, I don't understand how I'm going to get there. You pick up the same tools the enemy meant for destruction, you whoop him in his own game. You got financial trouble, say, I'm going on a mission trip. You start seeing your finances come in line. Oh, Bishop, that plane ticket's too high. Check out, you ain't going. It's too much money. Where's my list? I'll check my list twice. I'm like Santa Claus. Somebody comes up to me with a little hesitation, they ain't going to make it. Oh, Bishop, you're too hard. I don't want you on the airplane with me if you got a hesitation. I certainly don't want you in a village where people want to kill you and you're scared. You weren't scared, were you, Barbara? Barbara just had coffee with me and said, let's go do it. You scared, you staying at the guest house. Maybe they'll find you there. Where are we going? I used to tell them on our trip this last time, I'd say we're in a delay. Why? I don't know. Must be a reason. Let's just go chill out. God is able. This year, if nothing else, I want your heart, I don't want you to ever come in here with a frozen heart, a hardened heart. If you leave here today and you put it in the freezer, I promise you by the time you get here Wednesday night, it'll be hard. Amen? I didn't give you tonight off. God spoke to me. This is a God night off. This is a night to really adjust yourself. Get ready for this fast. Get ready to go into this next season of your life. And I want this 3 weeks to be the greatest 3 weeks that we've ever had together. Amen, in this fast. I truly believe we're going to hear supernatural testimonies come from this. The Sunday night, the last night of the fast, we will have a baptism here. Everybody's been asking, we're going to have baptism. I don't have baptisms just to have one. We're having one to close out this fast on the Sunday night, the 24th. And you got to sign up. See Doug. I think Doug's getting everybody signed up. Stand up, Doug. Wave your hands. See Doug if you want to sign up for that. Amen. I want you to sign because I want order, but we will not limit, you know, who does. Because God said, let my doors of the church be opened. Amen. I got a feeling that there's going to be some people that their hearts, you know. And the water, remember, the water don't do nothing. It's your faith stepping in the water that's going to do something. Amen. So tonight or today, study out the scripture. Know who you are in Christ. Remember what the enemy's meant for bad in your life. God will turn around for the greatness. Amen. And sometimes we go through the wilderness, count it a privilege that you're going through the season of your life because you know you're going to come out better than you've ever been. Stand to your feet, Sabrina, get a song. Praise the Lord that we come here today. If you need prayer, you don't know where you're going to spend eternity, you're not born again. Or maybe you really feel like, man, Bishop, this is really who, this is me. I really don't know how to get out of this place that I'm in. I'm telling you, let me pray and impart into you and believe with you today. And I truly believe that God will transform your life before you leave here today.